Lord, Lord. She has been good to me. I said, Lord, Lord, oh Lord. Oh, you've been so good to me. Well, oh Lord, oh Lord. You've been so good to me. You've been better. she had a lot. Thank you, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, yeah. Gotta thank you. That I gotta thank you. That I gotta thank you. That I wanna thank you, Lord. You've been telling me, Lord. I gotta thank you, Lord, yeah. I gotta praise your name.
At this time, we're going to change the order of service and turn it over to Sister Rose. Let's give her a hearty amen as she comes.
Yes. It's good to be here again tonight to see what God is doing for his people, proving himself day after day. I wouldn't trade it for nothing in the world. He continues to move by his spirit, and we are blessed to have him as our Lord and Savior. We are blessed that he looks out for us. Sometimes when you don't even deserve it. I praise him for his goodness and his mercy and just for what he can do if you dare to trust him. I've seen it over the years. The more you trust God, the more he's there. Honey, I pray for you every day. I was on vacation. Every day. Thinking about you. Yes. Saying, God, you save her. Help her. He's going to do it too. Anytime the Lord keep bringing you back and bringing you back, I never forgot you. And so I'm praying for you. Yes. God is so good and so wonderful. And I'm happy to be here to worship him and to lift him up in praise. They'll come and announce this about Mr. Blagojevich after I'm gone tonight, okay? And so I hate to mess with names I can't pronounce. The Bible has a lot of those. We just call it whatever we want to and keep going. You know, I used to hear my grandmother all the time. They be reading scriptures, and they get to some of them names. They say, well, so. It's kept right on going. And I used to be cracking up. I thought, that is not what that word is. But that's what they did. But we're just so happy for all of you that are here tonight for what the Lord can do for you if you let him. He loves you. He cares about you. In spite of everything going on in this world, he cares about you. And I'm thankful for it with all my heart. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Revelation, the second chapter. Father, I'm grateful tonight for your blessings, for all that you've done for us. It's a privilege to be in your house, to lift up your name. I thank you because you've never failed us. You loved us more than anybody in the whole world. Thank you for grace. Thank you for mercy. Thank you for being there for us, God, no matter what you've been there. And I thank you for it tonight. I pray, God, for the anointing upon thy servant, that your glory might be seen in this place. And we'll give you glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Yes. The 18th verse says, and unto the angel of the church in Thyatira, write these things, saith the Son of God, who has eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. I know thy works, and charity, and services, and faith, and thy patience, and thy works, and the last to be more than the first. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants, to commit fornication, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. I want to preach to you a little while tonight. God always allowed a space of time after he tells you something. This is what man plays with. The more I thought about it, I thought that's what they play with. You'll hear something, God tell you something across this pulpit or call you by name for something and warn you. And you know what? They'll listen for the moment. And then for the moment, they say, I'm going to do different. For the moment, they said, I need to change this. For the moment, things are going to have to be different. But you know what is so detrimental to man is that he underestimates his time. See, you don't know when God is going to bring it, but he's going to bring it. So prophecy throughout the word was given to men and women over the years that God said, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. And because they didn't see it today, and time kind of went on, they just kind of thought that everything, I ain't got to worry about it. You got to worry about it. If God says it, rest assured, he's going to do it. So when I looked at that, I thought, God said about Jezebel, now, I got somewhat against you because you let her seduce my people in the church. She called herself a prophetess. There's so many of those liars out today, you can't even count them. They're everywhere. Somebody, God told them something, God gave them a word, I don't buy it. Because the stuff they're talking about, if you know God at all and you know the scripture, you know for sure, hey, he didn't say that. He didn't say that. But when you know without a doubt that if I tell you God said, you rest assured he said it. I don't spend my life going through the motion and talking about this thing. That when I tell you something, you can count on it. Because God never said a lie to anybody. He sends warnings and warnings. He said, I allowed her space to repent. She knew what she was doing. You let her continue to do it. I allowed her space, time. You know, God is so long-suffering. He really don't want to have to really afflict you or hurt you. He don't want to do that. The scripture says, he said, he doesn't like to afflict easily. He doesn't want to do that. So what I do, I give you warning and hope, even though he already knows, you're not going to do it. Because he already knows when he sent you the warning that you still wasn't going to do it. But he just loves us so much, he does it anyway. With full knowledge that you're not going to take it, you're going to repeat it, you're going to go through the same thing again. He knows that, but I'm still going to warn you. That's what he told Ezekiel. He told Jeremiah the same thing. Look, I'm sending you to these people. They're not going to hear you. He said, they don't listen to me. You think, well, why would God send a prophet over to me? Now, they're not listening to God because I'm going to give them another chance. What God wants to do is give you another chance. But man is so playful and so laid back, and he don't really believe that it's going to happen like that. And I don't really have to do 100%. Yes, you do. God will not accept less than 100%. Think about it. Now, he said, the church allowed her to do this. They allowed this. That's why I say God is holding us as leaders accountable, that we don't allow things in the church that shouldn't be. He's holding Rose Banks accountable. If Colorado Springs get messed up and get into a whole bunch of mess and sin is all over the place, I will hold you accountable for that. God will talk to his leader. He will talk to them. So he said, you just kept letting her do it. He said, I know you're doing wrong, but I'm going to let you stay here and continue. No, that's not going to happen. If you're doing wrong and you're told you cannot stay in this church and continue down that path, you better believe that's a true word. And it doesn't matter how long you've been here. It doesn't matter what you put in the offering plate. It doesn't matter any of those things. If you don't take heed, you're going to get messed up. You keep warning people. I spend a lot of time with warnings. You better do this. You better do that. Sometimes the warning is just, you better change that. And sometimes it comes really, really strong and stiff. You better get out of there. You better get out of there. And the more you see them moving toward danger in a terrible place, you want to say, you better not do it. Did you remember what the Lord said? Did you remember that message? Do you remember that night he called your name? Did you remember? He called your name for a reason. He wants to be sure you got the message. You didn't send it over here, over there. I'm talking directly to you. Listen. The hardest thing for man to do is to listen. And he doesn't want to be told what to do. Listen. But he said, now, sometime when God has promised he's going to bring judgment, it's a bit delayed sometimes. That delay is about you getting it together. You know what they do? They'll get stirred up for the moment, and when you look up, they'll be right back where they were. The last time the Lord said he divorced some people in here, understand, you ain't just going to walk up here and say, well, you know, that bothered me. How bad did it bother you? How bad did it bother you? Did it cause you to say, you know what? I got to get out of here, and I got to stay out. This stuff is starting to stop and don't work. It doesn't work. You got to get in 100% and say, I'm not going back there. And if I see myself slipping, if I see myself returning back, I need to take hold of that and say, no, you're not, because God didn't send me a word for nothing. That's right. Surely the penalties are delayed because of mercy. Because of his long suffering. I don't want to do this to you. See, God has such wrath. You see why he holds it in check. Because when he moves in his wrath, boy, he tears up some stuff. That's why you got to say, I better not play with him. I better take this serious. I better realize that he's going to come again. And then that may be the last time that he come again. Then what you going to do? What you going to do? When he comes again, he's coming back. But one of those times is going to be the last time. Are you going to hear it? Or are you going to say, boy, I kept telling them that. And they continued to do the same thing. I watched Arlene say, well, you can marry me again. You meant that, but you got to stay there. If you don't, he'll shift you right back to the same place. He'll shift you back. Well, you know one thing? You're right out there, the same old dead place. Nothing lives in dead places. You got to say, no, I'm not going there no more. No, remind yourself, how did I get there in the first place? I should have spent time with God. I should have prayed. I should have sought him. I didn't do it. I put it on hold, and look where you are today. Don't do it. Don't do it. But the Lord gave me this message. So he just kept saying, I gave him space. All week long, till I finally picked up the Bible and began to study. I gave him space. And they still ain't repented. They still on the same place. Now, whatever place you were in that caused you to do wrong, if you have not completely left that place, wrote it off, you're going back to it. See, if I got there, because I didn't fast and pray, I didn't follow what I was told to do. You're going back. You got to put something in place so that I don't go back. So I don't repeat this. You got to put something in place. What I wasn't doing before, that's why I got there. Did you check that? Did you stop for a minute and say, you know what? I'm doing the same thing over again. Same thing. I thought about Cliff when he said, that scared me to death. How scared are you? Fear wears off. But I got to get stirred deep in my soul that I ain't. No, tell me that. Like, scared me to death. I'm trying to think, was that before or after when you were supposed to preach and you came in the office and said, I don't have a message? Was that before? That was before. And I said, oh, really? You going to preach? So you figured out. I'm not changing nothing. See, one thing about this church, you will never be able to say, I really didn't know what to do. Nobody can say that. Because week after week, day after day, you are constantly being told, you better stop that. You better leave that. That's dangerous. I knew somebody else who did what you did. Look where they're at. That's dangerous. See, we don't tend to learn from other people's mistakes. It's almost like I need to do my own mistake. I need to mess up my own stuff, Why can't you look at what happened to me and say, if that happened to her because she didn't listen, I'm not going to be there. You don't have to be there. You don't have to be there. So, but what's wrong with man? He's stubborn. Very stubborn. You can talk to him and he'll talk a bunch of junk and what have you. Look like he's going to do something he ain't doing. And I am amazed. I will look out over the church and think, boy, how did you leave that place? God touched you. We saw something new take place in you. How did you leave it? And why wasn't it so precious to you? I can't let it go. This is so important to me. I can't let it go. Whatever it takes, I'm going to do that. What happened? What happened to the praise? What happened to the freeness? What happened to the worship? What happened? I'm almost scared to say, so-and-so is doing good. Before I can get it out of my mouth, he's sure doing it bad. You almost want to wait a 6 months, year, 2 years, and see if they're going to still be doing good. Because we're people that fall into situations and we're forever getting involved with temporary things that we shouldn't be involved in, and you never really get it together. Always messing up. Always thinking stupid. I got to do some counseling a little bit tonight, and I was thinking, boy, these folks is crazy. Something's wrong with them. Because you know there's a hell. You know that you're going to die. The devil somehow has put this blinders on people as if, you know, it doesn't apply to you. You're going to die sooner or later. You don't know when. Do you understand? You could be here tonight, listen to this message, and it be gone, and you be gone tomorrow. That's as real as I'm breathing tonight. And I'm surprised. I'm thinking, do you know you're going to die? Do you know that you don't know what time God's going to say, I'm done with it? I reached out my hand, no man regarded it. I tried my best to get you to do it right, and you wouldn't. I tried my best to pull you in, but you refused it. Now he says, you're going to come to me, but I'm not going to answer you. You didn't want to do what I wanted you to do. Now you're in trouble. Now you want me to help you. I'm not going to do it. God says, I'm not going to do it. When your destruction comes, when it's so bad that you don't know one way from the other, let me tell you, God said, I'm not listening to your prayer. You don't know when he's not going to hear you. You're just messing around. And don't ever measure by what he did for somebody else. Don't ever measure by that. Because when this person got 6 months, you may have 1 week. You may have 1 day. You don't know. God knows the heart of people. Say, I got to get out of here. I got to do what's right. I'm not going to continue to stay in this place. I refuse to stay here. I see repeat over and over again. Preach. Repeat it over and over again, and they'll still do it again. Next time the message comes, they done it again. I'm thinking, something's wrong with you. Because if you know truth, if you understand, when God says to us that I'm going to bring judgment on this sin, I'm going to bring you down, he's going to do it. See, they won't repent, truly repent. See, they'll say, I'm sorry. I told the Lord, I'm sorry. That's all you said? No, we got to have godly sorrow. Feel it, the pain. I'm so sorry. I disappointed God. I'm so sorry I hurt him. I'm so sorry I didn't pray the way I should have prayed. There's no real repentance. I'm sorry. I don't consider that nothing. I'm sorry that I did. No, honey, you should be on your face crying out to God until he make the change. I won't give it up until he do it. See, a person that repents of sin feels regret that, wow, I wish I hadn't done that. Oh, if I could go back and fix that. If I could go back and change that. If I could one more time have the opportunity to do it right, you may not never be given that. Some people, they repent too late. A feeling or expressing humble or regretful pain or sorrow for sins and offenses. I feel this. I could not do anything that I know, have a knowledge of, that I know is wrong in the sight of God and do it anyway. People do that. They know this is wrong and do it anyway. You got to stop and say, wait a minute. You know it's wrong. Why are you going down this road? Look at what happened to this one. Look at what happened to that one. Don't follow that path. You tell it over and over again. Listen. Listen. They told me while I was on vacation that Walter Jr. left a message on the church line. I said, that's Sister Rose to call me. I said, call him. On my vacation? If I wasn't on vacation, you're not getting a call. I know I've done wrong. I just want to know if I can come back. No, you cannot. You're not going to send a message in this church that when you want sex so bad, you walk out the door, go get your full of sex, and walk back in and say, well, you know, I was wrong. You knew you was wrong before you left. Don't ask me to feel pity for you. I have none. You're not coming back. I'm not going to allow you to bring that in God's house. No. You ain't come back. Go back. Finish what you was doing, buddy, when you told Anthony, this is my life. Continue. You're not coming back here. What do you say to the other people sitting on the pew? Just do what I did. You know, I just went on out and had sex with somebody, and then after I got through, I asked Sister Rose, could I come back? And she said, yeah. Oh, no, she didn't. Oh, no, she did not. I said to the bishop, and I said, are you kidding me? I know I was wrong. I was in the midst of encouraging you when you walked. Encouraging you. Telling you, come on, you can do it. God ain't forgot you. You went on out in the middle of that, and now you done this, and you want me? They said, welcome home. Oh, no. Oh, no. You tried if you want to. Go ahead. Find you something out there, but you ain't coming back here. Find it. It's not going to happen. I was talking to my son Lamont the other day, and I thank God for his honesty, and he was telling me about something. He said, Mama, I feel like I need to tell you this because I never told you about it. I said, okay, tell me. I said, it's good you told me because if you hadn't told me, I would think you wouldn't change. Because people that's got something to hide, hide something. But if you're free, if you're totally free, and you finish with that life, you ain't gonna hide nothing. People in this church get in a bind. You know why? They heard the truth. They heard what God would do. They heard all these things, and still they sit here with their minds warped about what they're gonna do, how they're gonna do it. That ain't gonna work for you. I gotta receive this. I said, well, thank God for the truth. Yes. You better start having an appreciation for truth. Does it make you feel good? Uh-uh. But if you was in the place you should have been, you wouldn't be feeling bad because you would have done what was right. And see, you can't even look at me and say, well, Sister Rose did. I'm not going to give you that. I'd rather be dead than to give you a reason to commit sin. I'd rather be dead than to say, well, our pastor did. Oh, no, she did not. No, she is not going to. I looked at the other day, they had Bishop Long on Steve Harvey's show, and that man is the biggest, phoniest liar on the planet. He's sitting on there saying, Steve Harvey said, so just let me ask you this one thing. Did you or did you not have sexual relationship with those boys? I'm not allowed to speak of it. you of whether you can say I did or I didn't. Now, you may not can disclose the settlement, which was millions of dollars. You may not can do that, but I would be glad I'm sitting on a public place, and now I can answer, no, I did not. He couldn't say it because it was a lie. It was a lie. And Steve Harvey said, because, man, I have been long coming to your church and brought my family in. I even backed up from you. And he said, you know, man, if you wasn't guilty, why did you settle? You said you had five stones and you hadn't thrown one of them yet. What happened to them? See, you do your sin if you want to. Be sure your sin will find you out. And there he said, I'm thinking, you're still lying. Had 35,000 members and you got 10,000 left. And for it's all said and done, you won't have that. 25,000 people walked out on you. I saw this man years before this happened. God showed it to me. He says nothing but more than a pimp. I was walking by my TV and he was on there, Lord, and said he's a pimp. That's where the message come from, of the pimp and the prostitute. We had more requests for that on TV, over the air. People said, let me get that message. The pimp and the prostitute. The church, the prostitute, and the preachers of the pimps. It's a shame before God. I look at that stuff and I think, my God, do you not have any feeling? If you want to be a homemonger, if you want to play with little boys, get out the pulpit. Get out. Yes. So, we want a whole position, but without responsibility. This is responsibility lying on my shoulder. I am responsible as a pastor and a spiritual leader to walk this road right, to do it right, not one day, but every day. That you cannot go back on my life 5, 10, 15 years and I screwed up. Oh, no, you can't. If you went back 40 years, 50 years, you still couldn't do it. We are responsible to do it right and enforce that you do it right. People sitting up in churches going to hell, biggest day, doing everything they want to do. The preacher's endorsing it because he's doing it too. Think about it. Because I gave him a chance. I guarantee you before that stuff ever came out on Jimmy Swaggart and all of them, they had a chance to repent. But they didn't do it. Man, till because judgment is not executed speedily. It is set in the hearts of men to continue. Because God didn't stop you right now, you just keep going. So God didn't correct you right now, you just keep going. And he's giving you a chance. Why don't you stop? Why don't you quit? Why don't you let it go? Mm-mm. As long as nobody knows about it. He knew it from the day you started. From the day you started, he knew. I gave you a chance. You think you're getting over because God didn't reveal it yet? He's going to. It won't remain. He'll show you for who you are. Think. Think for a minute. I got to get it together. Before I let the devil take me on a road like that, Abby says, this road, pray for me. The devil's playing games with my mind, and I will tell you, you go pray. You go pray, because if you was praying, he couldn't take your mind. He that keep his mind stayed on me, I will keep him in perfect peace. So if my mind's on him, I'm not over here thinking about nasty, ugly things. No, no. Think about it. If you still got dirty thoughts going through your mind, you ain't saved. The Bible said the thoughts of the righteous are right. So if the thoughts of the righteous are right, what are you doing thinking bad thoughts? Why are you thinking all this stuff? I read in one of the magazines while I was at home. I read this before, but they put it in a book again about what a large percentage of church members, men, are into pornographic stuff. And he done made some CDs showing you how to get out because that's a brain sickness. No, that's a heart sickness. That's something wrong in the heart. Now understand. We had that to happen in here with a brother. Now, I don't see that brother have changed one thing that would say, I would never go back. There's not one different, not no change. Now, if I see you still in the same place, that means you're going to look at porn again. And when you do, you're out. You're out because you have to move from that place. Or else I'm going to end up in the same thing again. Get out. No, people go to porn because their mind is filthy. Saved people would never want to watch porn. I said saved people are not going, I don't care what he says, he's not going to watch porn. Now, when I give you a chance to make it right, and I don't see you walking in the path that you need to walk in, there's no praise, there's no worship, there's no prayer, you're going to do that again. I'm telling you, it's impossible to escape it. It's impossible. You have to move from that place. So I gave you a chance. I gave you a chance to get it right. I gave you a chance to stop doing that. That spirit will drive you in the midnight hour, all day and all night. They say it's one of the most demonic things that a man or woman could get involved in. It takes over your mind, your spirit, your everything, and you're constantly there. The internet is nothing more than a demonic machine set up to entrap people. To entrap people. Surely there are some good things out there here and there, but even the good things, if you gotta be careful what you punch. Be careful what you hit that button with. I was telling Nisa, I guess we was looking for a lingerie or something. She said, Mom, you have to be real careful how you put that in. Just lingerie? You got to be careful what you put in. You can't do that. You got to be careful. Don't put that in there. I said, wow, just off that word, lingerie? Mama, you don't know what you're going to get. Well, I'm not on the computer much anyway. Yeah, P, go on. But I look at this stuff and I think to myself, why do you want to do that? Because you are filthy. You're filthy in your mind. Why, when you looked at that book in the store and glanced it, and it had something on there that shouldn't have been about naked women or whatever, why did you keep looking at it? You're nasty. You've got a nasty mind, nasty thoughts, filthy, messed up, messed up. A righteous man's mind says, what in the world is that? I want to be sure I don't defile myself. David said, I'll let no unclean thing go, in front of my eyes. I won't allow that. So think about it. If God gives you a chance to repent, repent! But don't go back. So I repented, but I just, when I knew one thing, I was like, really? You are telling me that the grace of God is not sufficient. And I'm telling you that's a lie. His grace is sufficient. He can keep you from anything. That's why he came, that he might destroy all the works of the devil, every bit of it. You ain't, he ain't supposed to have no power over you. God said, when I gave her a chance to get it right, she still wouldn't do it. And that's where some people are. You warn them, they still won't get right. You say, you better stop that. You shouldn't be doing that. That's not a good thing to do. They still won't stop. You will see in the future God's lack of endurance with man. That I will endure some things. I'm long-suffering. Don't push it. Don't just do it. You know it's wrong. You do it anyway. Don't just do it. Go pray. They don't want to go pray. They'd rather do that. Help us, God, help us. This thing, God gave lots of people chances throughout the word to repent. They didn't do it. See? The prophet, Jeremiah said unto the prophet Hananiah, hear now, Hananiah, the Lord hath not sent thee, but thou makest this people to trust in a lie. Therefore, thus saith the Lord, behold, I will cast thee from off the face of the earth, this year thou shalt die. We say, well, yeah, the Lord said I was going to die. 7 months into that year, he died. 7 months you had a chance to follow your face as a lying prophet and say, God, would you please have mercy? Continue to go on and do the same thing. 7 months into the year, he was out of here. If God said it, if he says I'm going to move it, if he says I'm going to put a stop to it, if he says that's over, it's over. It's over. Quit playing with it. Quit playing with it. He said, you rebelled against God. You better ask yourself, where are you on the rebellious chart? Where are you? Are you in a place where you, I know what you say. I know. You said, well, didn't I tell you that? Yeah, Sister Rose, I know you did. Yeah, I know. Well, so why didn't you do it? I don't know. You didn't want to do right. When God, when King Nebuchadnezzar had the dream and Daniel interpreted that dream, he told him what was going to happen. He said, oh, King, let my counsel be acceptable unto thee. And break off thy sins. Break off your sins by righteousness, and thine iniquity by showing mercy to the poor. If it may be a lengthening of thy tranquility, God may let you stay. He may change his mind. See? And this, all this came upon the king Nebuchadnezzar. At the end of 12 months, he walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon, and the king spake and said, is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty? While the word was in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven, said, O Nebuchadnezzar, to thee it is spoken, the kingdom is departed from you. 12 months later, did you think that God was just teasing? He had 12 months. He says to him, don't you know that he might change his mind? If you'll do it, we never know if you repent that he'll leave a blessing behind. You can't keep falling on side. You can't keep doing it wrong. You can't keep making excuses. I'm going to get you. And you can say to God, oh, Lord, I really didn't mean it. I'm sorry I did this. I gave you a chance to stop. I gave you a chance to stop. And you are doing things with full knowledge. This crap about I got checked after the fact, that sucks. Why didn't the Holy Ghost check you before? I got checked after I did the act, after I did wrong, after I done that, what I shouldn't have done, I told the Lord to forgive me after I did it. Really? After you did it? Why didn't you say I'm not going to do it? Because that's why he came, that he might destroy the works of the enemy, that he might give you power. What are you talking about? I'm sorry. After the fact, no, now. I shouldn't have did that. I'm not going to do that. It's so much easier to say, no, I'm walking away, but the flesh loves pleasure to the flesh. Whatever makes the flesh feel good, it goes after it. And it don't want to let it go, so it repeats it. Keep on doing it. God said, I gave them space, Rose. I've given some people in this church space. I gave them time. Now, when you suddenly hear, she's dead, first thing you go back to, oh, my God, she got warned of that. You remember that night? Didn't change. So you said, I'm okay. You're not okay. If God doesn't say you're okay, you're not okay. You better quit playing them games. You better quit playing. That's why I said from the pulpit, I said, I'm not standing in no gap for you. You're still doing the same thing. If I'm going to stand in the gap, at least change. If you ain't going to change, why am I in the gap? I'm going to sit down. You know, when you stand in the gaps, you get all the hits. But now I'm going to take it for you, and you still don't change? And then want to stand up and holler at the wrong time. Just pray for me. I thought, go on. I ain't praying tonight. See you. It gets gets old after a while. It gets old. You know how many times I've been down this road with you? Again and again. Over and over and over again. Has to end. God said, I'll bring it to an end. My leader is not going to keep on dealing with you. Gave you a chance. Encouraged you. Talk with you. You came to a church where they pray and see God, and you just keep on doing it wrong. He's going to get you. Oh, King, when Daniel was talking to Nebuchadnezzar in the NIV version, he said, be pleased to accept my advice and renounce your sins by doing what is right and your wickedness by being kind to the oppressed, to the oppressors. It may be that God, through prosperity, it may be then that your prosperity will be continued. If you just, he said, take my advice. I give advice. Some people take it, some people don't. Some people change, some people don't. It's only up to you. Listen. In the next version, it says, listen to me. Stop sinning. Do what you know is right. Be merciful to the poor. Perhaps even yet God will spare you. Maybe he'll give you a chance if you'll just change that. Maybe. Do you know true repentance? No, wasn't nobody more wicked than Ahab was. Ahab was a wicked king and a no good wife, Jezebel. He wanted Naaman's yard, his vineyard. He said, I can't give you my inheritance. Well, then I'll pay for it. It's worth more to me than money. He goes home and lays up in the bed like an old dried up piece of shuck, crying and feeling sorry for his son's wife. I said, what's wrong with the king? Well, I wanted his yard, his vineyard, because it's close to my house and he won't give it to me. Then she sets it up and have him killed. And God said, you tell him. I'm going to bring judgment on him. As the Bible said, there was nobody else more wicked than Ahab. That man went down in sackcloth and ashes and began to pray and seek God, and God heard him. He said, tell him I'm not going to bring the payday in his day, but in his children's day they'll see it. What have you done in your life that your kids going to pay for? It's true. What have you done that your kids are going to pay later? See, it's a sad thing. He said, be merciful. And in the NRS version, he said, O King, may my counsel be acceptable to you. Atone for your sins with righteousness and your iniquities with mercy to the oppressed so that your prosperity may be prolonged. Maybe God will give you some more time if you'll just humble yourself, if you'll just pray. But they won't. I gave them a chance. Ahab didn't wait no long time. Ahab thought, wow, this is bad. I'm getting ready to go pray. You got people in here that you'll get that message or that warning. Go right on home tonight and go to sleep. I'd be up all night. God, you got to help. Help me. Could you go to sleep? No, I couldn't go to sleep. All I could think about was what God had said he was going to do. Go home and go to sleep. Get something to eat on the way home. Stop at McDonald's. Y'all are crazy. You better take this thing serious. When God says something, believe it. Believe it. If he said it, he will do it. He has never, ever told you he would do something and didn't do it. Be it good or be it bad. Never happened. Stop for a moment and say, you know what? I better wait. When Ananias and Sapphira come together to go into the church and lie to Brother Peter, they conspired this together. Well, Ananias went in before his wife came in, and Peter just asked him a simple question. How much did you sell the land for? Because at every time of the year, certain time of the year, at the end of the year, people would go in and whatever you had, you would give it to the church. I mean, share it with the church so the church things would be done and people that was in bad shape could be helped or whatever. And so to look good, he said, him and his wife then got together and said, why don't we say we sold it for this? So when we give this amount of money, it'll look like we're really givers. But he didn't know. Now, that wasn't no time. But now, during the time they were conspiring, they had time to say, we better get back up from this. We better back up from it. Okay? And he said, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Ghost? He said, and to keep back part of the price of the land, why did you do that? He didn't know God was going to give it to Peter. Whilst it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but you lied unto God. That's why you got to be careful. I tell people when I'm right on the telephone, think about this before you tell a lie. A tongue talk folks will lie to you in a heartbeat. Just shout it Sunday night. Oh, no. Mm-mm. I would never. You just shout it. I said, I'm going to go back over this again. Because that's not true. That's not true. So listen. 3 hours later, his wife comes into the church planning to stick to the same lie. Now, in 3 hours, she could have said, I don't think I'm going to do it. Your husband's dead already, but you don't know it. Because he done lied to Peter. So he's dead already. You had time. If it had been in your heart, you said, maybe me and Ananias shouldn't have done that. Maybe I should have joined in with him on that. Maybe I should have done something else. Maybe, God, I ain't going to tell Peter a lie. Wouldn't that have been something? Your husband went in there, y'all conspired together to do it, but on the way in within 3 hours, you thought, I ain't going to do it. I'm going to tell him what we really did. Oh, what? He's in hell, and you got saved. It happens to a lot of people. So I can't get saved because my husband ain't saved. He stays around long enough and you die, but your husband went to a revival that night and got saved and you in hell. Ain't that stupid? But when she went in, about 3 hours, the church was so startled, so shocked by what God had done. They weren't even talking. You think somebody would have met at the door and said, hey, Sapphira, your husband died. God killed them. People talk all the time. Everybody's so scared they ain't saying nothing. Your husband's dead. Did y'all sell a lamb for such a thing? I just come out here to tell you, warn you ahead of time. God killed your husband. Don't go in there with that. Nobody said a word. And she never made a decision. I'm going to change that. 3 hours you might have to make a decision, and you didn't make it, and it cost you your life. This service, you didn't make it, and it cost you your life. You didn't make it. You could have done better tonight. You could have changed that tonight. And you just went on out the door. You didn't change it. I don't have to get to Sister Rose to pray for me. I can fall on my face right where anywhere I can fall. So I said, what's wrong with him? What's wrong with her? I'm trying to get a hold of God because I'm a fool. What you crying about? I'm going to hell. I don't care how I look. Oh, I'd have been shame. Shame of what? Shame that you're in the wrong place. That's what you should be ashamed of. 3 hours. His wife, not knowing what was done, came in. And Peter answered unto me, tell me whether you sold the land for so much. And she said, yea, for so much. Peter said unto her, how is it that you have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of them which have buried thy husband are at the door and shall carry you out too. And she fell dead. There was no time to say, hey, it's over. Where's God going to catch some of you people? Right in the midst of doing something that you've been warned again and again, don't do. He's going to catch you in it and you're going to die in it. You're going to die. Don't be a liar, because I guarantee you one of these times, while a lie is yet in your mouth, you drop dead. Wouldn't that be horrible? He dropped dead while he was lying. Are you kidding me? Yes. You can drop dead like this. Be careful. This message tonight is a warning. Saying, here it comes again. I just keep sending it back. I hope I don't have to move against them. I hope they've changed. I hope they've done right, but they haven't. And I know they ain't done right because I see them all the time. I know they ain't done right. They ain't praying. I know that. See, Herod. Oh, in the scripture says, upon a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, set upon his throne and made an oration unto the people. And the people gave a shout, saying, it is the voice of a God and not of man. And immediately the angel of the Lord smote him because he gave not God the glory. And he was eaten of worms and gave up the ghost. Worms literally infiltrated his body and ate him up inside. Worms broke out in there, ate him alive. Because you didn't give God the glory. That's why you, when folks started praising you, honey, you don't need that. You don't need that. I thought Juana told Miss Moore, some of you stood up to start a clap. She don't like no oration. She don't like no standing ovations. Don't get up. One time I went on vacation, come back in, ain't standing up. Just clap. I thought, are y'all sick? Who you clapping for? Now, if you tell me you want to clap for Jesus, hey, we can do that. I don't deserve no ovation. Hey, this whatever I am, whoever I am, whatever I've accomplished, he did it. Now, you want to give him a hand clap? Hey, let's do it. Not for me. No. So that's not going to happen. Listen. Think about where you are tonight. The time you heard the message that troubled you and stirred you up, Cliff, Bernard, some more people in here, where you at right now? Are you in the same place? Because I see it all the time, this sudden change. Thomas, worst condition I've seen in ages. Worse. How did you get back there? This is the man that was up here on the platform. I mean, this man was talking in Sunday school. This man was shouting. This man was praising God. What happened? He left. See, you have to leave God to go there. Because he don't leave you. You have to leave him. What happened? Knowing what happened. If you got the praise today, you ain't got it. Next Sunday, where is it? No, I won't give you next Sunday. I'll give you Wednesday night. Shouting all over the place Sunday morning. Where were you? Where were you? Wednesday night you ain't got no victory? That quick? Oh. Something is badly wrong with that. Badly wrong with it. Thank God. Think about it. Not. You know what? You can tell when you slip. You can tell. Now, Anissa, when you first got back here, girl, you couldn't, I mean, you was up in the air. I just started watching you. Here's where you go, look. Like watching the clock. You watch the second hand go around. You don't even realize time is going that fast. Click, click, click. I thought she's slipping down. I brought you back. I gave you another chance. Not that you deserved it. But because I loved you. Yes. See, every once in a while you need to take inventory. Where you at? Where am I at? Have I been thinking about this before? Was my mind out here like that? Was I all messed up? What's going on here? How the hell is screaming the prayer line and come back Wednesday night and ain't got a win? You shifted in 3 days? Come on. Did you get it for real? You will not leave it if you get it for real. You couldn't pay me. Oh, no, no. Come this far, and then in the end start slacking up. Slacking up. Don't pray much. I'm still praying, but, yeah. The people that usually tell me I'm praying, they're not. Their life doesn't predict. It doesn't show that. If you've been praying, I can tell. You don't even have to tell me. I can tell you. I know you're praying. Like Michelle, she said, I didn't do it that time, but I pray. I said, I know you pray. But somewhere, right, the devil says, she's praying. Let's get her right here. I don't think I was on vacation. Was it a week? I don't know if it was a week. The devil had already set in. I'm going to fix this. I've been given some truth. I'm going to fix it. Where you at? shedding tears. One said, I don't know if I should tell you. Tell me. I said, that's the devil. I said, that's the devil. He got a plan. Better tell him to get away from there. You better get away from there. I said, I thought that thought was, Mama, no, you're right. I done seen the devil. You show, he come up on you. I seen him before. He makes a fool out of you. He go telling you all this stuff, this, you know, God's this and, you know, others is having you. I'm not old sleep K. Shut up. Mm-mm. Don't tell me. Sometimes they're in the middle of talking. I said, don't want to come. I said, it's a lie. I thought there's someone. Forget it. When I hear the first word, first thing I said, I made it a point. Yes. Usually when I'm at home on vacation, or on vacation if I'm out of town or at home, there's never anybody, church people around me ever. And I thought in the house one day, Matt and Denver was there. I thought, I feel like I need to get them out of here. Still church people. I'm constantly picking up. I don't want to pick up on vacations. Now, occasionally, I have to take care of business on vacation. Occasionally, but I don't want to pick up. See, walking through the house, I said, you need to put them in another room when I'm coming out. I'm going to work out. I don't need to see you. You're church people. Get upstairs. Mama's coming. Move downstairs. Mama's coming. Close the door. Don't want to. And I thought, wow, I didn't realize how much that affected me until I got rid of them. Get out. Because there's always some little nasty, little yanking, little ugly spirit always there, just driving you crazy. I didn't see that when I couldn't see them. I thought, wow. The Spirit of God is that sensitive that it picks up all these little nasty little things I see about you that's ugly. I don't want to see it. I'm having a good time. I'm resting. Every once in a while, the Lord has to say, Rose, you got to deal with this one. And I do. But if I can get away from it, I thought I didn't even realize how that affected me. I hadn't seen them. Don't come down till we tell you Mama's passing through. They had to see the strangest thing they ever seen in their life. Because they so sure they're going to be in the house there. We'll see, Sister Rose. We'll be talking. No, you are not. You ain't going to see me, and you ain't going to talk to me because I don't want to hear it. Because as sure as you talk to me, I'm going to pick up something in that talk. And I got to stop and say, stop lying, baby. Stop it. No, you're lying. You know you're lying. But I'll go ahead and say, I thought I can't take it. Got to be quiet. And I feel that. Not too much. I think I'm going to keep it like this. Wherever they at, I'm not. Because when I come in and say, I said, I still sometimes get it anyway, but not as strong. I said, boy, do you know that boy is lazy? He's sorry. I don't like that. My cousin one time said if he had a lazy bone in his body, he'd take a butcher knife and cut it out. I don't believe you should go to that extreme because you could get rid of it. I don't like that. I just want to pass this on to him for me. Because I'll be out Monday. I'm still not going to. I like it like this. It feels good. Don't have to deal with stuff. It feels real good. See, think about this. And then if I have to look at you, and I see you not doing what I told you to do, I'm going to tell them again. Where does this stop at? See? We need to be sure that we don't associate with the wrong type of people who tend to have a way of bringing us into places we shouldn't go because bad communication corrupts good manners. So I'm not going to be caught up with this person. This person always got something wrong in their spirit. It's nasty. I'm thankful for the time that I talked to Arlene and felt the change. At first I thought, what happened to you? In 30-some years, anytime I told you, you said, okay, mama. Now it was a, no, ma'am, that's not what it meant. I mean, that wasn't what I was doing. That wasn't what I said. I thought, are you stupid? I said, you're starting to sound like crazy church people. You want to continue to do that? You ain't going to make it if you start telling me that's not it. You tell the doctor, he says, you know, you got a tumor here. He said, I don't have a tumor. He said, well, here's the MRI that we took. Can you look at this? There's a tumor. That's not my tumor. You must have got it mixed up with somebody else. Don't we have a reason? It don't apply to me. Don't apply to me. Yes, it does. See? Think for a minute. Where am I at? Not the God ain't gave me plenty of warnings, corrected me many times, counseled me again and again and again. Where am I at? You know if you didn't change. You know if you're still there. You know that before I ever say a word. You know that. Without a doubt. Understand, you know, I've been saved all these years, and I am constantly watching things all the time. Okay, sure, I've done that right, done this right, done that right. Not that I've got a war going on, hardly ever, but still I'm checking. See, I'm at the last round of my life. I was looking at the Bible the other day, and it was talking about how he gave you 70 years and perhaps maybe 80, providing you're strong enough or whatever. I sit there and thought, I'm on the last leg of the journey. I got to be better now than I ever was. Whatever I did 50 years ago, I want to be better now. I think about it often. 70 years, 71. Wow. I got to be even more careful. I've been running this race a long time. Am I tired? Of course I am. But I got to make it. Somehow, I got to make it. And I know I'm going to make it. I don't play with this. I don't play with it. And I tell my kids, be sure when I'm gone, do this, do that. Be sure when I'm gone, they probably be hearing this more and more, more and more. Sure, be careful. Watch that. When I'm gone, don't do that. Watch this. Look at this. Remember this. Remember that. When David got ready to die, he put all these things. He told Solomon, to all the people, I need you to bring their hoary head down to the grave for what they did. God, don't give us that kind of thing anymore. That was under the law. Because I'd have to write a book. Be sure to get this one and that one and this one and that one and this one. See, I'd have to write a book. So he don't allow that under grace and truth. But I'm reminded. Don't ever take it for granted. I don't care how long you've been saved. Don't take it for granted. The devil says, I'm here till the last breath is gone. Now, you can mess up if you want to and preach to people. Paul said, I will bring my own body under subjection. Lest when I preach to others, I myself become a castaway. That ain't gonna happen. Oh no. I pray more now than I prayed when I was a new convert. I spend more time with God now than I ever spent my whole life. Oh, this is important. You gotta know, you gotta see, you gotta hear his voice. You can't afford it. And I gotta see people playing around all the time. You don't have to be 70 or 80 to die. I think you know that. You don't have to be. But ask yourself, as I'm closing tonight, ask yourself, have I got sitting on the pew? How many times have Sister Rose addressed me? I mean, get your mind off your brother and sister just about you. How many times has she warned me again and again and again? Where am I in this situation? Am I still in that same place that when she told me that? You better think about it. Because if you die, you will not be ready to meet God. You can't afford to do it. You got to do what's right. Check yourself. Tonight when you lay in the bed, look at your life. Go back and do some reflection on yesterday and the last time I heard that message. Did I move? Did things change? Or am I the same? But you got to ask yourself. Am I better? Do I pray more? Am I more consecrated? Am I willing to do it? What is God asking of you in the kingdom that you're unwilling to do? Ask yourself, where are you? Where are you? I'm thankful that I can say at this late date in my life that for sure, if death comes for me now or next week or next year, you rest assured. You don't have to wonder one time, did he make it? You better ask yourself that. And am I going to say that on the day that you die, trying to preach your funeral? They didn't make it. I know they didn't make it. I watched it. I told them. I warned them again and again to no avail. Look at your life. Take this message tonight. Take it home with you. Do not shove it under the bed. Do not disregard it. God is giving you a warning, saying to you, I gave you space. I've given you space. I've given you time. What are you doing with it? I've given you time. Where are you at? God's still looking for people like he did Adam when he went to the garden. Where are you? Find out where you at, because if your mind is not right and you don't feel the way you should feel, you better check that. Every night before you go to bed, you need to say to the Lord, Lord, what I don't see, show it to me. And you think he won't? He will. But what happens to people is a gradual shift. It's not one that the devil says, boom, and you say, oh, the devil just hit me. No. And after a while, he gives you a hit and it shakes you. He says, hold off. Then he hits you again. Think about it. Warning after warning after warning, saying to you, are you changed yet? What are you doing? Anthony, you better move in with God. I don't see nothing. I see you clap your hands with the music, but I'm talking about getting in with God. If you don't, the next time around going to be worse. It's going to be real bad. He been telling you that ever since you come back to the spring. You still don't see it. Shouted one time over here, God really touched that boy. You know he touched him. Shouted over here, I mean, he was shouting. Give me a few minutes. Whew, gone. What happened? I quit praying, and I tell people over and over again, you're not going to make it unless you pray. Without a prayer life, you'll never get to the kingdom. One, I think, asked Aaron, so why y'all stop coming to prayer meeting? You're going to hump yourself right on into hell. The devil says, I love it when people don't pray. Because if they don't pray, I can get them to do anything. Watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. Watch and pray that you'll do it right. God is speaking again and again and again. I speak to man once. I speak to him twice, and he perceiveth it not. After he goes to sleep, I come in a dream and warn him again. He still won't do it. Listen, you got to make up in your mind. God gives people chances. Noah preached 120 years that it was gonna rain. Them people still didn't get right. And at the last, after 120 years, while he's building the ark, they laughed at him. They mocked him. 120 years. God said, you got plenty of time. You can go in the ark. That's man, though. He's stubborn, rebellious, set in his way. I'm going to do it my way, and I'm not going to worry about it. You better worry about it. You better get concerned enough to start praying. When any little thing shake you up, any little change in your life shake you up, you ain't praying. When you pray, you won't have that. Stand to your feet.